Tithes family. We'll try that one more time. Good afternoon, GS family. Great, sounds better. Right, it's great to see you all again. Another Sunday to worship amongst you all, to see your shining faces, especially on Sneaker Sunday. I'll ask now, is this anybody's first time coming today? If so, we'd like to give you a guest card. All right, if this is anybody's last Sunday or next Sunday is going to be your last Sunday, please be sure to inform the chapel team. They'd like to give you a great send-off. Also, which is customary for us, give each other your best air high fives, best air daps, whatever is great to you. All right, welcome again.
Good afternoon, GS Fern. If you can stand up with me for morning prayer. Heavenly Father, we bless your name this afternoon. We thank you for the men and women who serve our country in the armed forces and those in leadership roles and for their families. Give them peace when this work takes them away from the family. We also pray especially for the wives, husbands, and children. For your words say, let everyone be subject to governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authority that exists has been established by God. For lack of guidance, the nation falls, but victory is won through many advisors. Thank you, Lord, for the advisors you've given us. Thank you, Lord, for sharpening wheels. For your word says, obey your leaders and submit to them. For they are keeping watch over your souls as those who will have to give an account. Let us remember her word and straight from you, Father God. Let us obey and pray for her as she cares for our soul. I ask all these things in your precious Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good afternoon, GS fam. Please stand with me as we read the responsive reading, please. It's in your pamphlets. Today's responsive reading is going to be from Psalm 29, verses 1 through 4 and 10 and 11. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord, the glory to his name. Worship the Lord in his fullness of holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders, the Lord over many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. Amen. We've been called to worship. We now welcome you to sing praises with the worship team.
Thank you. don't believe in fairy tales. I guess I've outgrown them. But that doesn't mean that I don't believe that there's something bigger than me. 'Cause I've seen it in a hospital room when the doctor said sorry. There's nothing more we can do. Well, it wasn't through. I've never seen a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. But I've got a promise I can hold in the middle of the struggle. God, if you said it, you'll perform it. May not be how I want you to, but here's what I'll do. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. I'm trusting your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Yes, I'm gonna wait on you. Yeah. I've tasted your goodness. I'm trusting your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. Yeah, you are the author, but there's no predicting what is next. But you hold the future, and all the questions, they come second to the one I know is true, yeah. Well, you've always been true, so I'm gonna wait on.
Yeah.
You should just wait. You should just wait.
You should just wait.
Instead of trying in your own strength, you should just wait. Instead of calculating what will happen if you go wrong, you should just wait. My steps are ordered by the Lord. Yeah, I should just wait. They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings like an eagle, and their soar. They shall walk and not get weary. They shall run and not faint. That's what happens when you wait. Happens when you wait. Hey, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings like an eagle and soar. They shall walk and not get weary. They shall run and not faint. That's what happens when you wait. That's what happens when you. That's what happens when you.
Some of us are a long 8 months for some of us, and some of you all are just getting here, but just that word of the Lord, like he says, if we wait on him, that we'll get stronger. That's the promise. And I really didn't feel like preaching today because I was just thinking, hey, that song is going to take over. We can actually dismiss, thank the Lord, and just go on out our day. But I guess I would probably get fired if I do that, so I'd make sure we go to the Lord. All right? So, to stand and revere the word of God as we're reading together. So if you're able, please join us. And we the world.
right. Verse 1 reads, I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false God. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you have done, the things you planned for us. None can compare with you. Were I to speak and tell of your deeds, they would be too many to declare. Amen. Lord, we just thank you for another opportunity to gather. Have your way in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and have a seat. Have a seat. Man, who here likes to wait? Let's just get it out there. Man, we got one person in this entire congregation who likes to wait. I am pretty impatient. I'll tell you, you'll see a lot of my impatience when it comes down to food. So I know y'all are tired of the food examples, but I just have to hit home there because I feel like it resonates with a lot of you, all right? So if I'm going somewhere, I cannot take lukewarm food. If I paid my money, I want it to be fresh out of the grease or fresh out of the oven. So I have a guilty pleasure, like McDonald's fries. No, they're not real food, but I do like McDonald's fries. And I will go to the window expecting fresh, crispy McDonald's fries. But of course, they're not fresh and crispy. So I'll have a little attitude because I know they're not, and I'll taste them, they're lukewarm. But I will go on the inside, and they'll say, ma'am, about 5 to 10 minutes, expecting that I'm going to say, never mind. But only God knows how much I like fresh, crispy fries. So I'm going to wait on those fresh fries. I also think about like cars. So I'm not into cars as much, but I know people who will wait forever to get a proper design, right? Like they don't want the car on the showroom floor where they can get it and drive off. But if you get anything custom made, you're not going to get your car immediately. Maybe not weeks, maybe not months, depending on what you would like to be done. But that's a special made order. And sometimes when we're calling out to the Lord about particular things, there are special made orders that he has. So he has to take his time. And so we have to wait on the Lord. And so I would say that Psalm 40 actually highlights three benefits of waiting on the Lord. Yeah, we're waiting. That's right, we're waiting. Did we send the right one? There we go. All right. The three benefits of waiting on God. This is going to be a very simple message. Is he hears you, God sets you up, and God gives you a new song. Straight from the text. That's what the text says. All right, so it's about 1:30. I'm going to get you guys out of here really quickly. Y'all are going to enjoy your Sunday, all right? But I just want to take some time and talk to you about this Psalm of David. There's not much historical context to this actual passage. All we know is that David is in reflection mode. He's reflecting about the journey that he's had. He's rehashing some of the things that he goes through. And you're wondering, how do you know that? Well, the three chapters before Psalm 37, Psalm 38, Psalm 39, he's experiencing much distress, and he's pinning it. But the very beginning of this psalm, he talks about waiting patiently. So we can infer that this 40th psalm is about his deliverance journey. Now, I'm going to put this disclaimer out here. Some of you all may feel personally attacked today. It's not because of me. I feel personally attacked when I was going through this message, right? So I just want you to know, it's not me. The Lord is going to do whatever he does to you all, right? So another disclaimer, this message, it's not going to be for everybody. If you're not easily bothered and you're pretty nonchalant, you aren't really looking to progress in your career or a particular relationship, And this message really isn't going to do much for you. So if that's you, you can be quiet, you can listen and share with someone else. But if you are a planner, if you are ambitious, maybe a little frustrated with some things in life or a particular circumstance, feeling like God isn't moving quickly enough in what you desire or what you want, I'd like to submit that today's word is just for us. And I include myself because I mentioned earlier that I can be kind of impatient. I got a bad ankle. I want to be healed. I want to get out there and run. So today or yesterday, I got on the treadmill to say, hey, I'm going to see if I can trot a little bit. It wasn't that time. Now, if I would have continued to push myself, I could have hurt myself prematurely. Maybe that doesn't resonate. Well, let's talk about a biblical example. Let's look at Abraham, right? God promised to make him a father of many nations in Genesis. But Abraham was old, and his wife was old when they received that promise. However, 25 years later, God fulfilled exactly what he promised to Abraham and gave him his son Isaac. Now, I use him as an example not because Abraham or Sarai was perfect. Matter of fact, the waiting process isn't always easy or perfect. The Bible reveals that his wife came up with this great idea and said, why don't you sleep with one of our concubines? And because she belongs to us, because she's our property, then this child that she has will be ours. See, that's a perfect example of an overachiever. Someone who comes up with a great idea, a great plan, and it sounds nice, but sometimes, unfortunately, we get ahead of what the Lord is actually trying to do. Thus, we make a mess. See, Abraham had to be an absent father from Ishmael's life because the Lord led him to put Hagar and Ishmael out because that was not his plan. The Lord still took care of them, but that was not his plan. The promise was not to be through Ishmael. So sometimes we need to, well not sometimes, and here we need to pause and let the Lord does what he does in his proper time. So I thank God for his grace and his mercy, but there are consequences to the choices that we make. See, there are some times that I've had headaches, which I probably didn't need to have, but because I didn't wait on the Lord, I had those headaches. There are some times that maybe you had some sleepless nights that you didn't have to have, but because you didn't wait on the Lord, anxiety kept you up. But I would say today that this passage will argue the benefits of waiting on the Lord. All right, so what's next? What's the next chapter? All right, we're going to start with verse 1. This is a very significant but simple verse. It says, I patiently waited. This is hard for us because we live in a very impatient society. People are just unwilling to be patient. We want what we want, and we want that thing now. This is a microwave culture that does not always recognize the benefits of waiting on God. Many people are tired of waiting on God and want to do things in their own might. So when we look at that phrase, there's two English words there that make up that phrase, waiting patiently, but it doesn't paint the full picture of what David is actually trying to express. There is one word that is used that I must admit I don't know how to pronounce, so I won't try that today, but it's one Hebrew word that is used to describe this two-word English phrase. Waiting patiently, expressed in the Hebrew context of what David was trying to write, actually means to be in a position of hope and expectation. I'll say that again. To be in a position of hope and expectation. What it's implying is I have something that I'm looking forward to God doing, or I have something that I want God to do for me, so I'm going to be in this posture of expectation and hope. I am looking for and I am believing that God can work it out. That sounds radically different from patiently waiting, right? Like waiting for the bus to come on the bus. That sounds like you know the bus is coming, but you don't have hope and you're not expecting. So it's this level of excitement knowing that the Lord is going to do what he's promised me to do, and I'll be committed to staying bound to him and connected to God to follow his ways instead of doing things on my own. And I mentioned earlier, it's kind of hard for us because, especially in this context, we are good at what we do. I'd say 99.9% of us are really good at what we do. And we can do certain things in our own natural ability. But this posture that David is asking us to do is say, hey, I'm expecting God to move. I am expecting him to do something. And I'm not going to quit because I know that he's going to be able to work it out. So why? Why? It goes to the very first point. Why wait? Simply because he turns to me and he heard my cry. In one passage, in the same passage in like the King James Version, it says, he's inclined to me and he hears. I use this version because the incline actually means turn. He actually strategically moves and turns aside into your direction. So James 5:16 says, therefore, if you confess your sins to one another and pray for one another, you may be healed. That second part is what I'm getting at. The prayer of the righteous person has great power as it is working. Or the King James Version that my grandma liked to read, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. This listen is listening with passion. There is a need there. It also is saying that you're in this right standing with God, not this perfection. I teach on that. We're not talking about being perfect, but in this right standing, this right relationship. He is your Lord. He is your Savior. Thus, he hears you when you pray to him. And so he turns. And as you're praying, that power is working. Thus, it is availing much to him. God is working even when we feel like he has forgotten about us. Because if we go back to the context, 37, 38, 39, he is in so much distress, so much turmoil. But he begins to start this 40th passage and saying, hey, even though I think that you have forgotten about me, even though I have felt forsaken at certain times, I know that he heard me. Out of the billions of people in this world, we serve a God that if you call out to him, he leans into your direction. So we can wait on him, because even though he's our heavenly Father, he always keeps us in mind. The word says he is mindful of us. Matthew 7:11 says, if you, then who are evil, because we're flawed, you who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to you, to those who ask him? See, the benefit of waiting is not in the gift. The benefit of waiting is knowing that he has the ability to give you what you need. The ability to give you what you need. Also, he heard my cry. He's listening, right? He's paying attention to our prayers. Now, this cry isn't necessarily tears. The Bible tells us that he captured our tears with a bottle, right? Like, if we cry. But that's not necessarily the context here. God is not necessarily responding to just our emotions. He already knows what's going on. Be expressive if you need me. So, this is a great example. So, your boss is getting on your last nerves. If your boss is here, stay looking straight at me, all right? So, your boss is getting on your very last nerves, and you are just ready for them to PCS, to move, to go on a TDY or something, right? And so, you're going to God, and you're mad. You're going with passion. Lord, you got to do something with this man or woman. I'm getting exhausted, right? So, you're there in passion, and you're praying, and he hears you, but he's not moved by that. This crying out and said, okay, I'm going to share and talk to the Lord and tell him exactly what I need. God feels you. He understands. But that waiting, that listening, that hearing, maybe the Lord is trying to give you some tools so that you can be successful and know how to work a future situation, right? Maybe the lesson is patience. Or even discipline to not say what you think that they need to hear. So after you finish crying, if that's what you need, you can ask God in the right mindset. You can say, Lord, I don't know how long I have to suffer long, but I'll suffer long. I don't know how long I need to be the light in this office, but I won't dim it. Help me to not feel taken advantage of. But in that, I have this posture and I have this expectation and this anticipation that one day this boss-subordinate relationship will end. One day, one of us will be PCSing. But in that moment, still while I'm dealing with it, God, not let me focus on my anger emotion, but let me focus on what you're trying to teach me. So I'd say the second verse. The second verse says, he lifted me up out of a slimy pit, out of mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a first place to stand. Now, I know if I was deployed somewhere in a regular gospel service, somebody would have got up and started dancing and shouting just off of that. I'm going to say that word again. It says, he lifted me up out of a slimy pit, out of mud and of mire, and he set my feet on rock and gave me a firm place to stand. Point two is simple. God will set you up. God will set you up. So, in football, whenever a wide receiver is running a pattern, a really good quarterback will lead them with their throw. This way, if they throw the ball and the receiver catches it, they won't necessarily run into an immediate impact, or it leads them to go into the direction that they need to go. Thus, it's protecting them. In basketball, there's this thing called an assist. If I pass you the ball and you catch it and shoot and make it, I get credit for the assist. Now, if you dribble or make your own way and go to the goal, I don't get credit for the assist. Matter of fact, there's some people like Michael Jordan who can score with two or three people on him with ease, right? But whomever passing the ball will not get credit for the assist. What I'd submit to you is that God is not that flawed quarterback or that flawed person who passed you the ball on the basketball court. He knows exactly where to put the ball. He knows exactly how to set you up. There's a regular assist where you pass the ball, you catch it, and you shoot. And then there's this fancy assist called the alley-oop. So as a person that's short and no ups, I will never dunk the ball. But if I put the ball in the right area for someone who can get up and get it, they will catch it and dunk it, and everybody goes crazy. It's an assist, but it was perfect placement. That's how God operates when he sets us up. See, that setup is not a betrayal. He is placing the ball exactly where you need it. The benefit of waiting on God, number two, is that he will set you up and he will plant you where you need to be. Uh-oh, that means even if it's dingy. Even if it's dirty and uncomfortable. Even when you're in the thick of things and can't find your way out. The word of the Lord says, he lifted me up out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. It's a sticky place, and you can't get yourself out of this situation beyond your ability. Matter of fact, I do this a lot because I think sometimes we get to a place where we've achieved so much or we've been walking with God for a while, where we forget about the sticky, icky places that we've been. I'm assuming that some of you all even have some testimonies that you would never tell a soul. What God brought you out of will stay between you and the Lord. And that's fine. But it's that dirty. And sometimes we have to be reminded that not everybody in here was always sober. Not everybody in here knew how to function. Some of you had to overdrink, but you don't have to do that anymore. Oh, some of y'all lied on your application to get in the military too, said you never smoked marijuana. But you don't have to live in that. Sometimes you were so high you did not even know how you got home. And I'm just I'm going to look straight forward and not look at anyone else. Maybe there's someone in here who they never say it, but they know I'm looking straight forward. I'm not looking at anybody. That they slept with so many people that they can't count. They can't remember. But it's been nothing but the grace of God that they don't have a trifling baby mama or baby daddy. It's nothing but the grace of God that they don't have anything that they cannot get rid of. It's nothing but the grace of God that we're no longer in that muddy, in that mirror, that mire, that slimy pit. And sometimes when we put ourselves in those thick of things, sometimes there's thick of things that we didn't place ourselves in, that we just happened to get there, and now we're looking around like, how do we get out? And then the Lord decides to turn to you, to listen to you, and then pull you right out with his mighty right hand. He's setting you up. He's putting your feet on that solid ground, that solid rock. So that if someone tries to say, hey, I remember when, you're firm now in the Lord. You're no longer in that city that you used to do all the crazy stuff in. You no longer have the baggage or have that abusive partner. Like, you're no longer in those positions. Your foot is steady. The word foot, feet, means your path, your walk. Your walk isn't perfect. You might have a limp with it, but you're walking. You're on this path. On this path that God has directed. Righteous man's steps are ordered by the Lord. So he lifted you up and he placed you and put you in this direction that you needed to be. So we thank God for the direction. We thank God for the purpose. We thank God for the assignment of a solid ground right now. So we gotta learn how to wait. We gotta learn how to stick with God. Do not quit. It will get exhausted, but do not quit. I know you're tired of coming to church every Sunday. You just want to go to sleep. Do not quit. I know you're tired of volunteering and singing and ushering. Do not quit. I know you're tired of going to work. Please go to work and do not get written up. Do not quit. And number three, I'm almost finished. I'm looking at the time. I'm right on time. And number three, after he hears you, after he pulls you out in due time. Number three says, he will place a new song of praise in your mouth. God will give you a new song of praise. He's going to take the blues out of your mouth. Yeah, this is a lady named Mary J. Blige, and she had this song talking about, I'm not gonna cry. And in the song, she was talking about a very bad relationship. And she was trying to make up in her mind that she was not going to cry, even though he was a horrible husband. But now, I mean, there's a lot of other songs that she has sung since that, right? She's doing just fine. Ooh! That, years later, there was a new song. That was probably not the most spiritual example, but there's a new song that the Lord placed in your spirit. Some of us had a woe is me perspective. Some of us had, why does this keep happening to me? But now God has placed a new praise in your mouth where you can say, if it had not been for the Lord by my side, y'all don't want to have church today, that's okay. If he wasn't by our side, that we wouldn't be where we are today. There's a new song that we have that God made all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord. So now we're not focused on what mama and daddy did. Yeah, they were neglectful at times. Maybe somebody yelled at you. Maybe somebody put their hands on you. And those things hurt. But you have a new praise. You have a new song that the Lord didn't allow that to distract you. The Lord did not allow that to destroy you, excuse me. Because he placed a new song in your lips, in your mouth. Could have had a nervous breakdown. You could have been mad, boy. decided to use you as an example. God decided that you would be the light for the men and women here at Instrument and whatever your next space is. God decided that he would allow you to sing a new song and that you'd sing it joyfully. You could have lost your mind, but your focus is impeccable now. You could have cussed someone out, but you decided that you're going to pray for them in your mind instead. The Lord has placed a new song, a new posture in us. And that only happens when we wait on him. It only happens when we patiently wait and have the expectation and hope, knowing that only God can do what God is going to do. Yes, he uses man to help us. But he is the one that's actually confirming and transforming our hearts. The word goes on to say, O Lord, my God, wondrous works, which you have done. He can't even count all of the great things that the Lord has done. There's a song that I heard, and it's called Million Miracles. And the artist is just singing about all the little things that we forget to thank the Lord for. If we really tried to write a list of the things that we were thankful for, the things that he has done for us, we'd run out of paper. The praise ultimately, though, and I'm wrapping this up, the praise ultimately, though, is so that others can go to the Lord and give him glory. It said many, the last verse of 3, it says many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. I remind so many people every day that the things that we go through are real and impactful, but they're ultimately for somebody else. You had to make it. Your son depended on you to make it. Your daughter depended on you to make it. Your little brother depended on you to make it. Your sister depended on you to make it. Because ultimately it was about bringing them into a relationship with God. They see daddy worshiping and they know it's not weird for a man to lift up his hands and praise the Lord. Exhausted, in the heat, long hours, but it's still not about us. God is developing something in us. And we might not know what that thing is while we're here, but I guarantee you once we step off of this base, he will highlight it to us. And I'd submit, most importantly, is to bring people to know him. If we lift Christ up, he will draw all men to him. That's all we have to do, is lift him up. Now, my question to you all, are y'all brave enough? Are you bold enough to lift up Christ? And I'm not saying being that annoying coworker that goes to somebody's desk and say, do you know Jesus? No, we're not talking about that. That's the reason why people don't come to church right now. We're not talking about that. We're talking about in your actions, how you love, how you patient, how you speak to somebody. Are you willing to wait patiently? Willing to wait patiently so that someone else can see the Christ in you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Whew. Heavenly Father, God, you know how hard it is to wait. Especially when we desire, when we want, when we've been praying for months, for years, and we still haven't seen the promise fulfilled. But I am so grateful to know that even a promise delayed is still a promise fulfilled. God, even though we don't understand why this situation has happened with us, why we're not getting the same opportunities as our colleagues, why we're not extended the same favor, God. Why we had to come to Insulik and somebody else got to do their tour elsewhere, Lord. We don't understand why, but we know that you're in the midst of it. We know that when we cry out to you, you hear us. We know that when we wait patiently, it's for you to set us up. God, and we're thankful that ultimately when we are being conformed to your image, others are watching to give you the glory. So now we can say thank you for that bad relationship. We can say thank you for not fitting in. We can say thank you that that job opportunity didn't work out. We can even say thank you that we didn't get promoted at that particular time, God, because now we have a different experience that we can bring in this new position, God. We can tell you thank you because we waited patiently on you. And God, when we tend to get anxious, remind us of your word in Philippians. We don't have to be anxious. We can come to you in prayer and supplication, making our requests known unto you. And we will come with thanksgiving. Because, Lord, you are a promise keeper. You are an emotional healer. Fall short, you are right there to pick us back up. So, Lord, as we leave this assembly, I ask that when we start to get anxious, when we start to get agitated, you just whisper, patiently wait. In Jesus' name. Share, got a few announcements for you all. So we still want to do our, you can keep playing, brother. we still want to do our first fellowship next month. June the 6th is the first Sunday, and it will be many of you all's last first fellowship Sunday and time here with Insulik. So please, if you are leaving, I'd say soon, in the next 2 weeks, please let me know. We like to say goodbye properly to our family members. We also want to do, everybody likes a home-cooked meal, right? We stopped for a while because I wanted to give y'all a rest, you know, and just enjoy and not have to worry about anything. But, you know, the Lord hears prayers and so does Chaplain Hughes. And so we're going to bring back... We're going to bring back some home-cooked meal. And so if there's anything that you want to bring, I've already tasked, like, two people with certain things. I won't put them out there, but y'all know y'all been tasked. If you want to bring your own specialty, please do that. You know, we got the Old Faithful that bring the juices and the cups and, you know, just keep doing that, too. I think that might be the only announcement. Right now, all of the chapel trips are still canceled, I know. People are looking forward to that. I want to make sure I say that every Sunday. And if something changes, we'll let you know, okay? All hearts and minds clear. I haven't asked you all that in a while. Yeah? All right, let's stand and be dismissed. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for watching over our families as we serve here in Insulik. We pray that you continue to protect them, continue to allow us to provide for them. Lord, watch over your blessed children as they exit this building, God, keeping their minds intact and keeping them focused on whatever goals and whatever aspirations that you actually placed in their hearts. And if there needs to be some realignment, that you speak softly to them today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.